Thank you, everybody. I have been living in San Antonio for about 35 years now, and I'm just kind of getting used to some of the weather here. But what I'm going to present to you today is really kind of a work in progress of my investigation into where we live. And I came upon the spark to do this sometime back in the 80s. I was working on a master plan for Alamo Plaza. And I thought I knew most everything you need to know about the Alamo and about the area around there. I mean, I'm pretty good on history, and I'd seen both movies, you know, John Wayne and the IMAX. And when I got into this work, I really found out that there was just so much I didn't know about that particular place and about downtown San Antonio. And then came to the realization that I really didn't know San Antonio all that well. I'd been all around it, but for some reason, my paths, my pattern of movement was really fairly narrow along certain corridors to certain places, and probably only really had physically been part of San Antonio's landscape in only about 5% of the area. So I made it a quest just kind of for myself to actually be in every place you can possibly be in San Antonio, which meant driving or walking every street, alley, easement, etc., just to get to know it. And over that time, I began to kind of formulate kind of this understanding the research and the field work of what historically how we developed, and also kind of a framework for a cultural landscape and how it's defined. For today's session, I really thought about, and usually this has been really kind of focused on urban form and development, but for today's session, I thought about kind of the implications it has for community health and health in the community. So with a couple of things, I want to dispel a couple of myths. And the first one is that San Antonio doesn't make any sense. The street system's all crooked and irregular. And I don't know, I was here in fifth grade, you know, back in the 60s or so, and I had a fifth grade teacher that said, oh, you don't want to go downtown to San Antonio? Streets are crazy and crooked. They were laid out by a Mexican on a drunk cow. Or it was a drunk Mexican on a cow, or sometimes it's both. And I heard that intermittently up through college and on, and so at finally at one point I realized that nobody goes out and just willy-nilly digs a ditch or builds a bridge or does those things. There's intent and purpose. So that was the catalyst, and I guess the passion for me finding out what was the actual reason that San Antonio has the shape it does. And so we're fortunate in that many of the records, even though they had to be interpreted, hadn't been lost in history. And so there is kind of a story that it tells. Now, why do we really talk about cultural landscape in this context? It really helps define the fuller context physically of where we are, because it adds to that in terms of time and human relationship. And it's important to architects. I think every important writer and critic on cities and urban development and architecture at some point has involved some notion of cultural landscape in the way that they think and in the way they describe urban landscape. I looked at it as really kind of a series of components of all the components of the natural realm and of that human imprint. And then really one of the most telling things about cultural landscape, how we perceive it. And when you look at the vantage in terms of time, scale, movement, position, and involvement, all of that influences how we experience a landscape and how one experience here can be very much different than the other experience at the same place. In starting with form of the cities, when you look at a map at this scale, all the cities look the same. They got some sort of downtown, they got some sort of radial highways coming in, they got some loops around it. So when you look at cities in this context, there's really not much difference, unless one is shoved up against a coast or something like that. So it really has to occur at that more intimate level. And the methodology I used to look at that was really going through quite a bit of archival research, doing the ground investigation and looking at putting all this to the same scale. Now, I know that just doesn't sound like real exciting, but nothing is to the same scale as historic records. Nothing is entirely accurate, nothing always points north, all of those things. And so it was real important for me to try to get that. And here are just some examples. Actually a very accurate map, although not scale-wise in terms of where things are, the Gallo map. This looks great, like it's really accurate. It's not even in San Antonio. It's totally mistaken, it's another location. Some of the later engineering, the Royal Engineers that actually surveyed and mapped San Antonio begin to give you more greater precision. Then up through the 19th century, all those wonderful itinerant artist views of cities across the country. Sanborn's becomes more apparent in terms of accuracy and full scope, and of course the USGS maps. This is what I used in my travels around. So after I started getting this information, I started drawing things up. Now this is drawn at a 1 inch equals 400 feet square. The actual drawing is about 5 feet by 5 feet. And what this shows is really what the initial landscape for San Antonio was back when it was initially settled 1718, 1719. Of course, San Antonio River, you see on your right-hand side, a lot of meanders. San Pedro Creek on the west, actually a fairly straight and shallow stream. The Presidio was actually located further north in San Pedro Springs Park, 1718. It actually got reestablished here in 1719. And you can see by the convergence of all the water courses there, it was really fairly strategic in terms of how it provided, took advantage of the river and the creek as a defense work. And then Mission San Antonio, which kind of bounced around from north down to the west bank of San Pedro Creek and finally over to the east bank of the river in 1725. It's located there on the right-hand side. And really what these were critical to was the road system. This was the major settlement in Texas at the time and would be for the next 150, almost 200 years. So the Camino Reales, the regional road system, all connected to this point. And then the way that this community was able to sustain itself was the acequias system, which I'll show a few pictures later, a series of irrigation ditches that took advantage of the San Antonio River and San Pedro Creek to provide irrigation and domestic water through the 17th and 18th centuries. So the mission had its own acequia madre. The town, actually the Presidio, had the acequia principal, and it took its waters from the head springs of the San Pedro Creek, and of course the acequia madre took its waters from the headwaters of the San Antonio River up by Incarnate Word College. And so that was really the establishment, Presidio, Mission, and the fields. And the acequias, to give you an idea of those that aren't quite familiar with it, is a ditch, okay? I remember sending a developer over to look at the Espada acequia one time, and he called me back up after he got over there. He was so disappointed, he said, it's just a ditch. He says, well, that's true, but these were really fairly, these were remarkable systems. They were engineered to almost at a precise 0.03% grade. The acequia systems, of which there were seven in San Antonio, really were skillfully built, provided irrigation water, to be able to make the community more sustainable because there were periods of drought and bad rainfall. It also provided the domestic water for households, which was really important. And you can see on the left, this is a Espada still being used on the Espada mission area. And then, of course, this is kind of the gates, the head mechanisms. You had to raise the water in weirs in order to divert water from the river or the creek into the acequias. And, a couple of structures to, this was the Espada Aqueduct, but there were about four or five other aqueducts in the system that actually carried the irrigation water over stream beds and lows. And today, even we acknowledge that. Of course, the restored section that's in Hemisphere Park on the upper left, you can see just kind of a commemorative section built behind the Hampton Inn over there, and even a section in Alamo Plaza where it's just marked, the Esekia was there, it's just marked in blue slate in the paving. So the Esekias are really kind of embedded, created the form of San Antonio, and we still look at them today. The initial settlement was just really by the Presidio and the Mission. They weren't obligated to plan in any particular way. But in 1733, the Villa de San Fernando was established, and it was under, there were settlers from the Canary Islands, came to, on the king's consent to come and settle in San Antonio and create the Villa de San Fernando. They're under obligations to abide by the laws of the Indies. And those are the planning precepts that really to govern the formation of, well, of course, all the laws and customs in the Spanish dominions, in the Americas, in the Philippines, but also to basically provide the planning precepts for the formation of all settlements and towns. They were kind of recodified over time, et cetera, but typically you'll see this as 1573 and then later under Juan Carlos 1680, these provisions. And these are books like, you know, 500 or so different articles or codes. It's interesting that they're all kind of, every fourth or fifth code, it was always emphasizing respect for native populations. These guys didn't get the memo. Yes, they just kind of slipped here. But this is to say that the conquest of the Americas by the Spanish and the colonization was not always abided to by law, and it was not always pretty, and it didn't necessarily create ideal communities. It did create some splendid cities in Havana and Mexico City, but nevertheless, I don't want to try to idealize or romanticize this whole portion. So this is really kind of one of the important directives out of the laws of the Indies. I would read this all the way through, but it is really kind of thick and kind of flowery. It's in the best language in the translation that it could make. But one of the interesting things that it does say, and I'll just read that first one, that take into consideration the health of the area, which will be known from the abundance of old men or young men of good complexion, natural fitness and color, and without illness, and in the abundance of healthy animals of sufficient size, et cetera, et cetera. So when you break that down, there was an obvious understanding that health in the community, health of people, is related to health of place. And the components of that meant that you had to have good climate, good air, fertile soil, good land, good resources, all of those. And if you really just kind of get this down to the basics, what the laws of the Indies was saying, looking at, make sure you have clean air, clean water. You have to look at a good site for its location and climate. You have diverse resources, and you have fertile soil. There you go. Nothing's changed. This really all goes back to Vitruvius anyway, the laws of the Indies. So, and today we struggle with clean air, right? Attainment. We're struggling with clean water, are we not? And we can't do anything about the weather or where we are, but we certainly can do things about its resources and the fertility of our soil biology. So all of these were thought of as important 300 years ago. They're still important today. There was some very prescriptive criteria for actual town formation. It should be centered around a plaza, a certain optimum size, certain prescription for streets. And all of this was done not by yards or meters, it was done in varas, which has kind of a range. It was officially 32.89 inches. It ranges sometimes a little bit more depending on where you are. But in looking at that kind of metric on that, that kind of helped me understand why the street widths in downtown San Antonio were always these odd feet. So when you look at it, alleys were 10 varas wide, streets were 15 feet varas wide, avenues were 20 bodies wide, they were even numbers in that system. So this kind of gives you an idea of the scale. And we talk about a league or the 8-league grant coming up. This gives you an indication of how big it is. So if we slip forward to 1750, the Canary Islanders have already arrived. They have settled right here next to the Presidio. And they pushed out the civil settlers that were already around the Presidio that were unofficially there, the squatters. And they centered the community around the plaza. And their village of Villa San Fernando wrapped around, really, the Presidio. The Bend area was the Potrero. It was really for protecting livestock in times of trouble or just a pasture. The Propios are essentially the immediate boundary of the town, and it was determined by really cross axes at the foot of the church, diagonal to the cardinal points, at which point there was drawn a quadrangle. And each one of those legs from the foot of the church to the midsection of the boundary is 1,033 varas. Why? You'd think just 1,000 varas could do it, 1,033. Well, 1,033 varas times 4 equals 1/4 league. So that's your quarter section, you know, that you use in the township or English system. So they had ways of just kind of measuring then. And so they could grow the town within the proprios without permission of the king, but they could not expand into the rest of the grant without permission. And that's how it was set up. Now they, of course, the Camino Reales, you have settlement across San Antonio, this is across Texas, this is becoming more of a hub. There was expansion of the Acequia Madre at that point, down further downstream. Acequia Principal down into this whole lower field area, the Labores Abajo. And then to the missions, the first one is Concepcion, Acequia Payache. So that begins to establish all these other points or character of land tenure in 1750. And all of this was laid out. You know, they used compass and they used instruments and they used survey chains. And so it wasn't just willy-nilly. This is a painting by Jean Thiel. Basically, we have a survey party about 70 years later, but very much in the same character. And so on the greater scale, about 1800, you really had San Antonio at the peak of its point of history in the Spanish colonial system. There was a revolution after that. You had Mexican Revolution, Mexican Republic, Texas Revolution. You had Civil War. So really from this point forward, really San Antonio is pretty much stressed out for the next 65, 70 years. So this was kind of its peak at this point. This is the greater area, which is shown in the light green, which you see, oops, see here, is the 8-league grant to the Canary Islanders. All the rest of the land was owned by the missions. And yeah, we went through this. So it's really the Via San Antonio by that point. And the Pueblo del Alamo really formed the dual poles of what was downtown. You had Mission Concepcion, Mission San Jose, Mission San Juan, and Mission Espada kind of leapfrogging downstream. And the Acequia Principal, which cultivated all the land between its Acequia and the river, really fed the, was for the civil settlement. The Acequia Madre was for the Mission Alamo, which is Mission San Antonio, the Alamo, and of course Mission San Jose, San Juan, and Espada all had their Acequia systems as well. So a whole pattern of ditches, sublaterals, señorios, which is the maintenance path right next to the Acequia, all began to put an imprint on this place, as well as the 8-league grant itself. And that kind of awkward quadrilateral, as it was called in the description by the surveyor himself, basically had to move that around. He would have preferred a nice, neat little rectangle at an angle around that, but he got in, they got into a dispute with the, with the missions, so they had to adjust that. But interestingly enough, really where it's adjusted is at the key strategic points of access to the city itself, which is the hilltops on the north and east, and the fords across the creeks and the river along the south and west. And when you look at those relative to the Camino Reales, all of those points that really about which are defined are key access points. And so when you hear the kind of description, the Seven Hills of Rome, this is really along the same lines. This is what defined this whole geomorphic square around San Antonio were those particular elements. Now, back down to this scale at 1800, the population had grown from a couple of hundred to about 2,500. You had additions, they expanded Barrio del Norte from the civil settlement. The Potrero was settled. The Mission San Antonio had been secularized and was now Pueblo del Alamo, its own separate Pueblo. Barrio del Sur, the south, and of course Laredito across the creek, kind of into Indian country, but nevertheless there was actually another acequia coming down through there that sustained that. Expansion of the Camino Reales, and then you had massive expansion of the acequia labor, the upper labor, Labor Arriba, and then you also had substantial expansion of the acequia for the acequia madre. And all of this was to feed a greater population. So the city is growing, it's overtaking some of the immediate agricultural land and is expanding others. And it's this pattern, this agricultural pattern of land tenure that begins to establish a pattern which the urbanization of San Antonio really does follow. What is the character of San Antonio about this time? All these paintings are by Theodore Gentile, who was an Alsatian painter living about 1850s up into the turn of the century in San Antonio. San Pedro Springs, of course, was a cool, wonderful, relaxing place to go fishing. People did use the springs in the river for washing, but they did not use the acequias for that. That was purely for drinking water and for irrigation. The plaza didn't have a lot of trees in it, didn't have the arcades around it. It was really a dry, dusty place, but that's where you had fiestas, that's where you had events, that's where you had games. The streets were probably like they described them when they would make official visits and they would write about San Antonio saying it's a miserable place, the streets are crooked, you got all these mud huts, it's miserable. It doesn't look real attractive here. I guess it kind of fulfills the whole idea of how it was being described. But it was a very active town. It did suffer its disease and drought, but it actually moved from pretty much a subsistence type of economy to one that was exporting its agricultural goods. And by the turn of the century, actually was doing very well. Again, kind of the notion of the character and the street life was going on at that time, where everything happened in the street, everything happened in the plaza, and life occurred there. A bit of a reconstruction by George Nelson, kind of a view from the southwest. And you see over in the kind of the middle right hand, kind of a row of trees there. And something interesting happened in 1800. The plazas were a prescriptive part of the plan of the laws of the Indies, but by 1800, what happened was they expanded the Alameda, which really was kind of something, a new planning idea that came out of Seville, kind of like the Coors or the, you know, the Esplanade. Essentially, it was an Alameda was a walkway between alamos, which are poplar trees in Spanish. And the poplar trees that we have are cottonwoods. And so what they did in 1801, on the outskirts of town, they planted two rows of poplars, and that was a place to go stroll. You didn't go do that in the plaza. This was a different kind of environment, a different kind of setting that was shady, that was out in the breeze, that had the acequias running on each side of it. Was actually very much of a comfort zone. And this was painted late in the life of those trees. Cottonwoods don't live but about 50, 60 years before they start to fail. And you had that interesting kind of element coming in. Now, what happened with the city subsequent to that was that, of course, it was no longer Spanish colonial or Mexican. It became the Texas Republic. It became a state. And by that time, there was a dispute over the who owned the city land. Because the king owned the land, the Spanish colonies. Mexican Republic said, no, city of San Antonio now owns the land. But there were people living on it, and there was a big lawsuit about it that basically said, excuse me, let me go back one, that basically said, you know, all this land, the city does, it went to the state Supreme Court, nobody could claim the land except the city, so the city held title to it. Now, at that time, what the city did was that they surveyed it, and they platted it out, and they drew up, there was two guys. One was the painter, Theodore Gentile, who was actually a good draftsman, and the other was a buddy of his, Francois Giraud, who did he was the first city engineer, designed the Southwest Craft Center, the old Ursuline Academy. And they came up with a plan to take all those crazy kind of angles and knit them together so that you really had a series of through streets in downtown, and where all of those kind of grids that were turned different ways met and connected at some point. So it was a really good exercise. And then all they did was establish pretty much of a cardinal grid from there out. So what happens is once the city gets its land, it turns around and sells it all. And not surprisingly, or I guess, the people that buy the majority of the land are all the city commissioners and county commissioners. So we finally get past Civil War, Reconstruction, and in 1875, just before the railroads come in, the city really has about quadrupled in size now. There's about 5,000 to 6,000 people. It's really the railroads coming in along the edges of town. This is before it really explodes. You really have settlement that is taking over all those fields. Agriculture goes further out. Ranching comes in a bigger way. And you have a series of public squares that were established. San Antonio very much being developed, kind of still being measured in varas, still being very Hispanic and Latino in its culture, and still kind of building the city according to those precepts. So you've got, for each little neighborhood, you really started to get little plazas and parks at that kind of intimate scale around there. If we jump forward to 1925, by this time you really have the full urbanization of San Antonio. There's the only green spots you see in there are parks. There's no agriculture in downtown. And yet you can see really kind of by the streets and the alleys and the patterns that you see, that agricultural pattern of land tenure really kind of fossilized within the street grid system and within the block geometry. At that time, the city is starting to move along faster, develops a streetcar system, replacing its old mule pulled system, of course. And it channelizes the river because, you know, those meanders, they just slow the water down, and we need to get that water quicker out of there so it doesn't flood. Well, that didn't quite happen that way. It flooded for an entirely different reason than meanders, because we had cleared so much land that it couldn't you know, all the runoff just came barreling down. So there's some disastrous floods at that time. And also rebuilding of bridges, new bridges, rebuilding existing bridges. So what's interesting about the San Antonio River is that the people are always astonished why it's so small. You know, it's really, we're expecting a river. But every street has a crossing practically. And that is one of the particular characteristics of its scale and charm. If we move to 2000, we're kind of at the end of all of this, you really have a city that has, in its buildings, taken on the shaping of those blocks from those early patterns, not just in the shapes of the buildings, but also in the way that the townscape has so many offsets and changes. It's not just a through grid. But what really happens by 2000 is, of course, an expressway system that really comes in on the northeast and west sides of downtown. And it's great, it improves regional access to downtown, it gets its regional access kind of up and elevated and off of the downtown streets. Unfortunately, what it also does is sever about almost half of the street the surface street connections from the surrounding areas into downtown. And also, there are a lot of other associated street closures. You know, expand a school for Hemisphere, for urban renewal. And so really what happens at this point is that the whole character, the urban character grain, if you will, of San Antonio changes from one of small blocks and narrow streets to bigger blocks and narrow streets, okay? And that the expressways are not really just regional access, they're localized commuter access into downtown. And that's a little bit tough on downtown. West side dies, east side dies, north side actually starts to fall off quite a bit in terms of just their economic vitality, their cultural sustainability. Also, a fully developed regional transportation expressway system by that time, and just account for the road, the railway transportation systems, pretty much see it's all radial and concentric at that point. That overlays this form, and which I've defined really as kind of a mosaic of geomorphic radial and gridiron street patterns, overlay the natural divide between hill country and prairie, and it really results in an episodic and polymorphic city form. And in going through this research, I basically, when I was going around and looking at every place, I had a map with me, and I'd highlight every street I was on, or every place I was on. And then I'd lose the highlighter, and I'd have to use another color highlighter, and all. So I started to get these kind of this map kind of all colored up, and I thought, what if you color coded the street character, and that would help understand kind of the graphic depiction of it as a cultural landscape. And so after some trial and error, that's exactly what I did. I went through and just kind of codified the Camino Reales all the way down through the expressway as street pattern types, and then started to put some colors to it to try to understand it. So this was very much of a kind of a trial by error approach. The pattern that's most important to all of this is really the terrain pattern, which is expressed here just in the stream beds, the topo lines being too complicated to show. And then accounting for, you know, the streets that derive from the Acequia patterns, streets that derive from the land grant, from the laws of the Indies downtown, going through these ranch grants that were made after the Texas Revolution, secularization of the missions for the mission land grants, the Cardinal Grid, the Camino Reales, and then the more modern things like the expressways, the drainage streets, the hilltop streets, all those curvy little streets in the subdivisions, those types of things, and of course the railroads. So this was my attempt to kind of understand form, but also cultural expression of San Antonio as an urban landscape. Can you tell me quickly how much more time is left?
15 minutes.
15 minutes? Well, okay, I'm getting ahead of myself. Thank goodness. So what does this all kind of mean to health and everything? And I think my concern, first of all, I wanted to dispel the myth that San Antonio has a bunch of irregular, nonsensical streets. There's not one street in San Antonio that wasn't built without a real purpose. And I think what happens, San Antonio having this episode, cultural episodes, where you get Spanish colonization over an indigenous population, you get an American, Anglo-American invasion over a Spanish and Hispanic population, you get this kind of overlay of dominating cultures that you see long-term all across the rest of the world, like in Europe, where there'll be the fourth or fifth or sixth dominant civilization in the same place. When that happens, the dominant culture basically just, you know, says the previous culture didn't know what they were doing. You know, it's terrible, it's awful. So you see a lot of bad things, you know, just the pejorative about, you know, as a classic case in course, I had a white or Anglo fifth grade teacher that was telling me, you know, that it was a drunken Mexican on a cow laying out the streets. That's the way of saying They didn't know what they were doing until we got here. You got the Spanish accounts of the Indians just building miserable mud huts. And when you go back and look at the archaeological record, which probably is starting to get known a little bit better now, there's actually was a building culture in San Antonio going back to at least 2500 BC. So probably many of the jacals and the early structures were perfectly capable of being built by the people who'd lived here for several thousand years. And so the succession of each of these tends to glorify their work that they do and to look down upon the work that was previous to it. So the myth that I really wanted to kind of get to was, number one, there's a real purpose here, and it has meaning, and so let's take that into consideration. It may not be relevant, but let's take it into consideration as we're going through and amending this landscape. And the second thing was, and I'm sure you, how many here are planners? Okay. And so everyone has heard, you know, been in a situation where the developer will say, oh, that's crazy, we're not going to build sidewalks. Why? Nobody's going to be walking. It's 106 degrees in August, right? Did anybody hear that before? I just heard it in there, too. And so the other thing I kind of wanted to attack was one of the biggest impediments to people being active and being just walking as a normal part of the day. I'm not talking about sports and all those things, just normal part of the day, is a terrible walking environment. It's an awful walking environment in San Antonio. You can find no sidewalks, cracked sidewalks, next to the best streets in town in San Antonio. It's very hostile when it comes to a pedestrian environment. We are worse than Houston. We are worse than Austin. We are worse than Dallas. We're even worse than San Benito, Texas, which has a great walking culture, surprisingly to me. And so what I've always heard is that it's too hot to walk in San Antonio. So I wanted to go to a psychometric chart to basically kind of understand where we are, which is in our latitude and our temperature and all the records that we have, from 65 degrees to 85 degrees, basically from 8 in the morning to 8 in the evening, all the days of the year, it's comfortable about 28.4% of the time. Sounds pretty bad, doesn't it? But only a third of the time can we get out there and walk comfortably. And when you look at it month by month, you say, okay, you know what, it's really bad in August. I mean, it's just below our average. But the reality is that most of our discomfort days are cold days in San Antonio, not warm days, all right? It's too damn cold here to walk. Can't do it. So.
That's insane.
I'm thinking, you know, how do we look with everybody else? Because we're on the same latitude as Cairo, for goodness sake, you know? And people in there at least dress okay for the hot weather. And so I looked at Cairo and then we looked, okay, what are the four most walkable cities in the United States? New York, San Francisco, Boston, Philadelphia. The same chart says that when it comes to climate, it's less hospitable to walk in that climate than it is here. In fact, it's not as bad as Cairo. And the nicest place I've ever walked in my entire life is Nice. I mean, who wouldn't get out and walk any day of any time of day, any day of the year in the Riviera? And that's at 24.5%. Those are the wet bulb, dry bulb, humidity, temperature, et cetera. Okay. And everybody watch the news, watch TV news, watch the weathercaster. When it's going to rain, what does the weathercaster say? It's going to be nasty. Watch out. There's going to be accidents. The rain's going to kill you. The rain's going to make you have an accident. It's going to make you have an accident. And I don't want to keep expounding on that, except to say that a steady diet to people, well, you're constantly hearing weather's bad. If it's raining, it's bad. If it's too hot, it's bad. If it's too cold, it's bad. And children hear that, and they don't walk to school anymore, and they don't ride their bike to school anymore. They have to be driven to school anymore, and the weather guy says that the rain's going to kill you, and all this stuff. We are putting weather as really kind of an enemy to us being outside. Weather and climate is being used as a reason to not build sidewalks, because why would you walk in the heat anyway? And to me, that the cultural aspect, the cultural uses, and the cultural interface between cultural landscape and cultural use and cultural attitudes happens at these points. And so I don't wonder if out of this conference there can't be something that starts to address in a very fundamental way, not just we need more shade trees. You bet. We need a shade tree over every sidewalk in San Antonio. Got to have it. It's a hot place. There should be shade trees over every sidewalk in Cairo, but they don't have the water, okay? But along with the notion that we have to be outdoors more and that we have to be more active and that that puts some pressure on that, I really feel that there needs to be kind of a, not just community health, not just healthcare that addresses the community, but a community-wide discussion and appraisal of where we are relative to other people's climates. Come on, get off it. We can complain about congestion. Go to San Francisco. We complain about climate. Go to Philadelphia. Man, I mean, we really have it good here. And we complain a lot. And people everywhere complain. From New York to Cairo, I bet they complain in Nice all the time about the damned weather. So the next time I hear a developer, I'm going to give him this and tell him he's full of it. And I hope the next time you hear that, that you'll tell them that too. And I hope you tell anybody that knows a weatherman, they ought to shut up. And they ought to like their job and talk about the weather as if it was interesting and they enjoyed it, instead of they couldn't get the sports job or the anchorman. So anyway, that's my madman spiel. I hope this has been interesting for everybody. It's more of an approach to the urban design of things, but I think health and use has a lot to do with really what makes cities be what they are. And I would just kind of like to leave you with a quote, who's one of my favorite guys, Ed Bacon, that we really can't think that we're going to design everything and capture it. We really have to kind of keep an open end to everything that we do, so that the next generation, the next great idea, has a little bit of room to move in it. So thank you very much. Questions, anybody? Yes.
You have to show the slide of the Alameda. Can you point out where that was? And
the Alameda, I'll show you on the map, you'll recognize. The Alameda was this section of Commerce Street, really pretty much between Alamo and Bowie, right in there. Because the Acequia, there was a west branch of the Acequia Madre that came down, and that's what you see, the little, in the back of the Alamo. It came right down through here, and that's why Alamo Street has that bend. And then there was an east branch of the Acequia Madre that came down here, that's why, and then it joined back here in Hemisphere Park. So that stretch between those two acequias was the Alameda. And it was called Alameda Street for many years until it was turned into East Commerce, I think about 1895. Yes?
I had a question on a friend, Conrad Cruz, with the Walking, Talking, Breathing Encyclopedia about something going to be involved with Conservation Society and stuff.
Oh, yeah, Conrad, yeah.
Conrad, yeah. Just a good friend. And he told me that there were plans one time, and I'm wondering if there still is, to that drainage ditch beside the Alameda, that that was going to be redesigned into a river, more of a flowing river, back to like a flowing river. Do you know if anything?
Well, the river extension for Hemisphere, that's what you see, that little kind of canal. Here's the natural bend of the river. And then this was the extension of the Riverwalk into Hemisphere here. And that was actually between the two Asakias. But so it wasn't an historic feature at all. It was simply excavated in the 1960s to carry the water over there.
It wasn't a river at one time?
No.
Coming from San Pedro Park?
No, never. And the other thing is that a lot of people will mistake the bend as being artificial and that the river went straight through, and it's just the opposite. Of course, the previous maps, you know that the bend was natural and the bypass channel was put in back in the 20s as part of the flood control improvements.
Mm-hmm. Most of the people that joke about the crooked streets here are talking about St. Mary's. And I finally came up with a theory as to why that was like that. Sitting over at the driving range one day, and I'm just looking across at the area where the Sunken Gardens and all that is, and there's the stack there, the smokestack from the old cement plant.
Correct, you're right.
And I thought, well, that was what it was. That all of that rock that was quarried out of there and hauled downtown in these great big heavy carts, there was no road to begin with. It was just a open pasture between up there and down there. And if you've ever been on a deer lease or someplace where you've got roads going out through the pastures, you know, they get loblollies, and so you have to move the road over, and then you have to move it back over here. And I think they just kept avoiding the areas that they'd already gone through in the low places, and then wound up with a road that just meandered all over the place because of the carts. That's my theory anyway.
Well, it's wrong. Sorry. I'm sorry. You know what it is. St. Mary's was basically because it was a path that followed property lines up to that whole area. That was an access to get up to the headwaters. So there was a path going up there. Who knows quite where it went. But once those parcels were platted up there, it followed that line that basically followed the line of the Asakia, the upper Labor Asakia, that came down from the headwaters on the west bank down to about where Luby's is now, yeah, just north of downtown, and then went back up to San Pedro Springs Park. So what it does is it actually follows that gradient that the Asakia was, the course of the Asakia, but at some distance to it.
I had looked at some old maps that
now,
had nothing platted out that way.
Now, I would say that when they dug the Asakia, they probably did have to scoot around to avoid things and they usually try to create a pretty straight line, but they would also cut to where it was, if they had some, really tough material, they would try to move, cut a little bit further where it was softer. So the variances in there could very well have been something that you described. Anybody else? Yes.
It's actually the San Pedro Creek, and next to the Alameda Theater, not the Alamo, what I was talking about.
Alameda Theater? I'm sorry, say that again then.
I think it's San Pedro Creek. It's not basically the drainage ditch.
Well, San Pedro, yeah, San Pedro Creek then.
Are they going to renovate that?
Yeah, that's actually a project I'm working on.
Okay. Did I miss that?
Probably, so it was at the very beginning, basically showing San Pedro Creek runs right here. And it was a natural course of the creek until it was channelized But it was channeled, it wasn't greatly diverted when it was channelized. They pretty much just went right on the existing stream. They went deeper and wider to create a larger ditch, or a larger channel for the creek. And the interesting thing about San Pedro Creek, and interesting thing about San Antonio, the first environmental legislation was actually in the 1750s. And after they had been working the land for about 20 years, they noticed that the sakias were getting washed out and silted up. It was becoming a really big problem. They investigated why that was happening, and they had been clear-cutting wood in Monte Vista area, of course, just north of that, for years and years and years and years. You got, you know, wood for fires, wood for construction, wood for fences, wood to make lime, just, you know, burning gobs and gobs of wood. They cut down so much of it that they really were making the slopes unprotected, and the rainfall was just washing out the topsoil. And at that point, they said, you know what? We got to stop cutting the wood. They stopped. They had a law that said you were forbidden from cutting a tree like within 2 miles of San Antonio. So you had to take your gun and go out there where the Indians were going to scalp you to cut your wood and then come back. You couldn't cut it any close to town. They also went ahead and did a lot of work on the acequias to protect them better, embank them. And then the third thing they did is they planted trees all along the acequias and the river just to stabilize the banks. So those guys are on top of it, you know, like about 200 years before we were. They knew exactly what to do. Anybody else? Okay, well, thank you.